Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you for the organizer for the invitation. The argument of this talk is, in some sense, is a quite elementary statement because it involves some quite not too complicated object, and also the proof of the theorem and the corollaries are a long, quite tricky and a long list of technical computation, but each one is itself all elementary, essentially linear and multilinear algebras. And for this point, this part of talk, it would be sufficient also a short communication. But since this is a school, as the organizer said, I want to give some motivation of why I arrived to prove this result, which is quite far from my background in algebraic geometry. It's a purely result in algebra. And the starting point, at least for my personal background, is the formation theory, which is the main topics where I'm involved. And in the formation theory, a very important fact, which appeared quite recently, is the fact that if you work in characteristics, it was pointed out in a very strong way by Deligne in a letter to John Milson about 30 years ago, that if you work in characteristic zero, every deformation problem, which is a classical notion which is due to Grothendieck, Mumford, Schlesinger, and so on, can be described, controlled by, which is a formation problem, which is a very complicated object, which a lot of things which are related in a, sometimes in a not very clear way, so the tangent obstruction map, higher obstruction, higher mass product, and so on, universality, semi-universality, and so on. All this data, which is a priori quite complicated, can be controlled by a simple, single algebraic structure, which is a differential graded Lie algebra. And this is one fact. And the second and more important fact, that if you take two differential graded Lie algebra, which are quasi isomorphic, so the same homotopy type, at least in the standard model category of differential graded Lie algebra, then they give the same deformation theory. So I would say this was, at the beginning, was expressed just the principle, which, I don't know, at least Deligne says as just a philosophy or a principle. Then, after that, people start to work on this just to understand better. And if you look in the lecture notes of the Konsevich course and Berkeley of the formation theory, this is stated not just a principle, as a meta-theorem. There is some attempt of proof, at least in the algebraic case. But nowadays, there is some, especially a lot of works by a lot of people, Hinich, also all the people working in derived algebraic geometry. Now this is considered a very standard result. There is no mystery. No more mysteries about this fact. Actually, the way which we can describe a deformation problem, but just by taking some suitable resolution and Coffey-Brandt resolution and so on, they give some nowadays a very natural result in characteristic zero. Well, of course, we consider all the fields of characteristic zero. Anyway, I mean, the application would be the complex number mainly. Okay, let me recall briefly the basic definition, just to fix the notation. A DG vector spaces are just a complex of vector spaces.
Before we enter the details philosophically, is there a proposed answer over the integers in the characteristic zero? Is there a proposed meta theorem?
I'm not aware of that. Because the problem is that the fact is that the real utility is the first thing is that for instance, if you consider the formation of some algebraic data, the equation involves some associative products at the beginning and also equivalence, but then you can see at the end that depends only on the underlying Lie structure, and in doing this you have to take exponential. So probably this is the main reason you have to work in characteristic zero fields. Over the integers, you need to have some different structure, not only the Li.
Li so
yes, you have to replace it with some other, with some more complicated, some other. I'm not aware of those. I'm just telling. I live in this small part of the world. Okay. Anyway, I'm interested in, for me, the only field is the complex number, sometimes the real. But yeah. Okay, G vector V is just a complex with a differential of degree plus one. A differential graded Lie algebra is essentially a Lie algebra object in the category of DG vector spaces, which is written in a more elementary way. It is essentially the data of complex of vector spaces with differential of degree plus one plus a homogeneous bilinear bracket, which is homogeneous degree zero in the degree of the algebra, which is alternating in the graded sense. This is a symmetric graded, which is satisfy also the graded Jacobi identity, and it also satisfy the Leibniz, graded Leibniz, so the adjunct, the differential D becomes as a derivation of degree plus one with respect to the Lie algebra structure. Okay, this is just by call the basic definition. Now, let me, the basic example, at least if you are interested in the formation theory of complex or algebraic manifold, is the so-called Kodaira-Spencer differential graded Lie algebras. It is, consider a complex manifold, consider then the holomorphic tangent sheaf is a locally free sheaf, so essentially of the section of a holomorphic vector bundle of the rank equal to n. Consider the space of differentiable form embedded in this tangent field, and then consider the Kodaira-Spencer DG Lie algebra is just to take the Dolbeau complex. Sometimes it's convenient to change the sign to the differential, take minus the bar, but this is not really important. It's up to isomorphism already, it's the same things. And consider the bracket, which is the natural bracket, which is the net. So you have a natural bracket, which is the bracket of vector fields. You know, holomorphic complex vector fields are particular kind of vector fields, and then extend by imposing that they are bilinear with respect to the anti-holomorphic differential forms. This is a natural bracket. Another property of this naturality is that you take the Lie derivative, it becomes a morphism of Lie algebra, so commutative brackets, these are the characterizations. Of course, the Dolbeau theorem says that the cohomology of this differential graded Lie algebra is just the cohomology of the holomorphic, the sheaf holomorphic vector field, tangent sheaf of the variety. Nowadays, this is the homotopy type of this differential graded Lie algebra controls the formation of X. I don't want to enter in details how the differential graded Lie algebra controls the formation. This may be all of you who have at least heard something. So you take Maurer-Cartan equation, take the solution, we take the Dirichlet tensor with the maximal, at least infinitesimal deformation, take tensor of the differential graded Lie algebra with a maximal ideal, or some Artin of differential graded Artin sheet, take the Maurer-Cartan solution, the set, take the quotient by the so-called gauge action. Actually, this is not important now. The only important thing is that the basic theory that if you have homotopy equivalent differential graded Lie algebra, they give the same deformation problem. So let me recall what is the quasi-isomorphy, or morphous graded Lie algebra is clear, the notion. A quasi-isomorphism is a morphism which is an isomorphism in cohomology. The homotopy equivalent relation differential algebra is you have some connection by some zigzag or some sequence of Guise's homomorphism, but using homotopy fiber product, it is very easy to see that it's not necessary, just have a zigzag, but also two arrows. So, two differential really algebra, LM, are Guise's homomorphics. You can find another aside the differential really algebra and two Guise isomorphism. Sometimes you can choose, it is always possible to choose F and G also sort of surjective, and this in some application maybe also useful. Anyway, I don't want to enter into details how from differential algebra to deformation theory, but the basic fact is that if we have two Guise isomorphic the algebras, differential algebra, then you have then the deformation theory is the same. So it is natural now to ask when homotopic type your differential algebra is easy, and then give some easily computable deformation theory. Now, there are two natural notions. The first is the notion of formality. Formal differential algebra is formal. This is a notion which goes back to homotopy theory. And also in conceived formality theory, formality is intended also in this way. The same homotopy theory of course, you have two particular cases of simple differential algebra. The first is when there is no differential, and the second then where there is no bracket. This gives two notions, the notion of formality, which are differential algebra, which are equivalent to someone without no differential, only the bracket, and the second is the homotopy abelian differential algebra. Then when you have that a Guise isomorphism with the differential with only the differential and not the bracket. These two notions are not transverse, but are one implied the other. In fact, it's very easy to see that a differential algebra is homotopy abelian if and only if it is formal, and moreover the bracket is trivial in cohomology. So if you have a differential algebra, then the bracket, by Leibniz rule, induces a bracket in the cohomology, giving a graded algebra structure in the cohomology of this graded algebra. Now, of course, if you want to study, for instance, the formation theory of a complex manifold, the first question that you may consider, take the Kodaira-Spencer DG algebra of a complex manifold, and ask if it is homotopy abelian or it is formal, with just the simple cases, the most optimal situation. In effect, it is then, by general theory, that if the Kodaira-Spencer algebra is homotopy abelian, then you have considered Kuranishi family. This is also, you have that this is a universal family, so you have no infinitesimal trivial automorphism, and this is an obstructor. So you have a smooth, fine, local, fine moduli space, which is the point of deformation theory, is the best that you can have. If the Kodaira-Spencer algebra is formal, then you have the Kuranishi family. Maybe singular, but the singularity is quite mild. So this is a quadratic singularity. So you define it by just quadratic equation. And so you have, in both cases, you have some nice regularity result on your local moduli space. Let me give some few examples. The first is just by very, very cheap. The projective space is formal. The Kodaira-Spencer projective space is formal, because here you have the cohomology of the Dolbeau complex is all concentrated in degree zero. H0 is ordinarily algebra with trivial differential, the formality. Another less trivial fact is the Bogomolov-Tian-Todorov theorem. Consider a projective manifold which has a trivial canonical bundle. Then in this case, the Kodaira-Spencer algebra is homotopy abelian. So it's quite isomorphic to an abelian differential algebra. This implies, in particular, the classical Bogomolov-Tian-Todorov theorem. Projective also manifold with a trivial canonical bundle as a universal deformation, which is smooth of dimension, the expected dimension. Another example, here is another, the Vasava manifold is the, it's also mentioned in the Griffiths series, the first example of a non-Keller manifold. It is take the space of upper the triangular matrices with this kind of matrix with complex coefficients. This is a Lie group with take the quotient by the subgroup where you take x, y, and z just Gauss integer. You obtain a compact manifold which is a trivial holomorphic non-trivial volume form, which so the canonical bundle is trivial, but this is not Keller because there exists a holomorphic one form which is not closed. This is easily to find. Okay, in this case it is possible to prove, it is not difficult, that in this case the Kodaira-Spencer algebra is formal, but it is not homotopy abelian. So in this case, this implies that in the Bogomolov you cannot remove the projective assumption in the Bogomolov-Tiantolov theorem. Another example, this is essentially due to Adrien Douady in an old paper of Seminaire Cartano, I don't remember well. You take just the Vasava manifold and take the product with just the projective line, so you get here you have two manifolds, each one of which the Kodaira-Spencer algebra is formal, but when you take the product, then the Kodaira-Spencer is not formal. So this implies that the formality is a quite fragile, so it's not very robust notion. You cannot expect, this implies that in general you cannot expect that you have this formatting. In fact, as the last example, consider, if you read the Ravi Vakil's paper on Murphy's law, you learn that you can, there exists always a complex surface algebraic with ample or very ample canonical bundle. What such that is a basis universal deformation space, Kuranishi family, is defined by just by one cubic equation. It is possible to find it. This is just a rather complicated construction. We pass through some configuration space, then take some abelian cover, then a generic upper plane section. So, it is possible to find. In this case, just by general principle, the Kodaira-Spencer algebra is not formal. The deformation theory is obstructed, but the bracket is trivial in cohomology. This is just a warning because there is an evergreen error also. Periodically appear in archive some papers that the author says that, so since the bracket is trivial in cohomology, then it is an obstruction. No, this is false, definitively. So, now let me give, I want to explain, so I mentioned an important result, which is the Bogomolov-Tiantodorov theorem. Now, nowadays we know essentially three kinds of proof. The first, which is the most sparing in the literature, which is essentially the original proof of Tian, is that just by using which is called in literature the Tian-Todorov lemma, which was called at that time, and in a more modern language, essentially bypassing through the Batalin-Wilkowski structure, which we have in the algebra of the polyvector fields. So in this case, the contraction with the volume form can be composed with a holomorphic differential, give an operator which induces a Batalin-Wilkowski structure, and using this structure, it can easy to find that plus some other the bar lemma or some other degeneration fact can be used to prove the Bogomolov-Tiantodorov theorem. The second fact, which is just by using the derived Griffith period map, in the case of when you have a holomorphic volume form, it is proved that you have some derived the local Theorelli theorem, and this implies just the Bogomolov as a consequence at Bogomolov. This is what talk I see the Carmelo Di Natale last week, and maybe also the first talk in the afternoon by Domenico Fiorenza is involved by this map. And there is another way, which is probably the shortest proof, which is use a Cattano motivi form and derived brackets, which I want to give a brief sketch of this proof because it's not very difficult to find in the literature. And the proof goes in this way. So, okay, consider I have to me. I'm probably a little bit late, but anyway. Consider the RAM complex of this projective manifold. Now, the bar lemma implies that the exact form is a complex, which is acyclic, you have no cohomology. Now, consider, both these are not related, well, consider all the great, the complex of the inner endomorphism of this, the RAM complex, also this. These are, with the degree shifted by one, these are a structure of differential Gödel algebra by taking this strange bracket, which is the graded commutator of this product. You see, this is a degree one, but becomes a degree zero when you take these shifts. It is can be interpreted in the theory of derived bracket, in the sense of Kozul, Voronov, and so on. But anyway, this is not important for us for the moment. Now, if you consider this differential Gödel, this M with this bracket becomes homotopy abelian because, again, by the bar lemma, this inclusion here the bracket is trivial just because G goes, if G, the image go to the bracket, then here the bracket, this bracket is trivial here. This is a quasi-isomorphic, again, by the bar lemma. So M is a homotopy abelian. And if you take the contraction of vector field with differential forms, the Cartan holomorphic, the class standard Cartan holomorphic formula show that this map is a morphism of differential Gödel algebra. Now you have a basic ingredient. Again, by the Calabi-Yau assumption, they say that this map is injecting cohomology just because taking the contraction with a volume form gives this isomorphism. And now the basic result algebraic here is that if you have a morphism of differential Gödel algebra such that the target is homotopy abelian and the map is injective in cohomology, then also L is a homotopy abelian. So you have some transfer of homotopy abelianity, and this is a result which is used a lot of times and very useful in deformation theory. So the proof, the first proof that you can imagine, you can, if you work passing to the minimal homotopy classification of L-infinity algebra, if you consider this map, if you consider L-OM also some minimal L-infinity algebra, then because trivial. It is also can be proved just by remaining in the category of differential Gödel algebra by taking some fiber product, fiber homotopy. So anyway, it is quite easy to see, but it is quite important because it has a lot of application. Of course, this result considers only homotopy abelianity. So the natural question, if there is some analog of this lemma for formality, because it's another question. The first naive generalization is false because it is easy to find example just by taking just a quadratic cone, which is a not quadratic special hypersection. That if you take morphism differential algebra, which is injective cohomology and M is formal, then it is possible to prove that this is not formal. The L, and then we need to replace the condition of which is injective in cohomology with some other which is stronger. Now, this stronger condition requires the notion of Lie-algebra cohomology. Lie-algebra cohomology, which is in the original of the definition, was defined by Chevalier-Heilenberg by some complex. This complex extends in immediately to the graded case, and then Okay, for instance, you take consider a gradle algebra, for example, the cohomology algebra of a differential gradle algebra. Okay, next consider, for simplicity, a morphism of gradle algebra. The fact is enough. It works also if M is just a Lie module over L. Then take an integer P. You can find P is the degree, internal degree. Then you can may define a sequence of cohomology group, which are the sequence of this complex, where the differential up to some sign, which essentially depends the differential is if you take in the first step, if you take an element, you take an element of M, go into the inner derivation associated to this element M. Given a linear map, you take his differential is if this is equal to zero, this is essentially the Leibniz property. So it means the length for how much the differential of an element of zero if and only if phi satisfy Leibniz rule. This is a derivation, and then you have also you can extend this just by some. So these are essentially the standard definition given by in the 48, I don't remember, by Chevalier Allenberg for defining the cohomology of a Lie algebra. Here in the graded case, you have to choose the sign in a good way, but not, it's just a technical, not very difficult property. Okay, as a, it is immediate to see that if they the H, the first cohomology group is that the element of M which are commuting with the image of L. And the most important, the first cohomology group is essentially all the derivations from L to M of degree P, quotient by the subgroup of inner derivation, the derivation which are obtained by as adjunction of element of M. Now we can, having introduced this cohomology group, we can state finally the what is the analog of the key lemma for the formality instead of homotopy abelianity, and here we can prove that if a morphism of differential gradle algebra and the target is formal, and if the induced map here in cohomology in the Chevalier-Allenberg cohomology is injective for every n at least 3, then also L is formal. This may appear a condition which are very difficult to check in concrete cases, but for instance, if you take, since this group depends only by the structure of M, L module, if for instance, L is a direct sum, well, not as a graded Lie algebra, but just an N module, for instance, if M is L tensor sum algebra, unitary algebra, you take an extension of scalar, then in this case you have, this is not, so in some cases it's not very complicated. This result is related also with the intrinsically formal different graded Lie algebra. A graded Lie algebra is called, this is a definition I found in a paper of Hynek and Tamarkin, which are related with the Tamarkin proof of Koncievich formality theorem. So there is, here in this paper you can find the notion of intrinsically formal graded Lie algebra, which is called, graded Lie algebra is intrinsically formal if a differential graded Lie algebra whose cohomology is K is formal automatically, so every deformation of this is formal. Then there is the basic result, the first result used by Tamarkin in his proof, and then proved in the paper of Inich, is that if you take a graded Lie algebra such that this cohomology group Hn is equal to zero for every n equal to is in intrinsically formal, it is essentially proven an immediate consequence of the key lemma, because take m is equal to zero and you obtain this, but it's not also the case. There is another application. Okay, now consider, if you take, just if you remember the notion of this, the notion of H1, you see that you take H1 is the set of derivation up to the inner derivation. So if in general you take a gradle algebra, you have you can define quite naturally the Euler derivation. So take an element of degree n and multiply this element for n. This is a Euler. In every graded vector space, you have the graded morphism. You see, in the case of if you are a gradle algebra, it is a derivation. It's called a derivation. And then this gives an element in the first cohomology group of degree zero. Now, another fact which is possible to prove is that if this Euler class is trivial in the first cohomology group, then the algebra is intrinsically formal. Actually, this gives a very, so this implies that you have several examples of intrinsically formal gradle algebra. For instance, if you take a gradle vector space, take all the endomorphism, it is a gradle algebra, it is intrinsically formal. Because, for instance, you see here the Euler derivation is just the bracket, the commutator with the Euler map in V, by a simple reason. For the same reason, if you take all the homomorphisms non-negative degree, or the homomorphisms non-positive degree, also these are gradle algebra which are intrinsically formal. Again, for the same reason, if you take any graded commutative algebra, take all the possible derivation of this, this is a gradle algebra which is intrinsically formal, and also for the same reason, also you take also the differential operators. Take gradle algebra, commutative, say, the differential operator is a gradle algebra which is intrinsically formal. Okay, this is a very, an example. Now, all these facts are consequences of a more general result, which concern differential gradle algebra. So the first step is to extend, give the natural extension of the Chevalier-Lambert complex to a differential gradle algebra. Here, in the graded case, you have for every p, you have a complex, horizontal complex. Here you have a double complex, which is not single. Because, you may define here the Chevalier, this is the same formula as above, just forget differential. I consider just a graded algebra in this differential. Now, if you forget the bracket and consider only the differential D, here you have the natural extension, also the differential gives just by Leibniz rule, here. This is the differential, the induced differential, and this is just by choosing the right choice of signs. This gives a double complex because you have two relations, and the double complex, and this double complex, the total complex associated, gives a cohomology which is the natural extension of the Chevalier-Lambert cohomology of a differential gradle algebra. Not only, but as an every double complex, here we have a spectral sequence. Take the filtration associated to the, so take horizon in the part of the Chevalier-Lambert differential, the filtration in this way. You have this filtration, and this gives a spectral sequence, which is, in this case, P is at least go from 0, 1, so this spectral sequence goes in the half plane. The right half plane. Now you can study this spectral sequence, just very easy. The first, which are easy to see, is that if you take at the second page of this spectral sequence, you recover the cohomology of the Chevalier-Lambert cohomology of the cohomology of the differential gradle algebra. This is a gradle algebra, and then you can recover this cohomology. In particular, you can define the Euler class in this as an element in the second type of the spectral sequence. Another easy fact, which is not difficult to see, if you consider all the positive pages from R bigger, strictly bigger than zero, these are, this part of the spectral sequence is invariant under quasi-isomorphism. So this is a homotopy invariant of differential Gödel's algebra, as well as the Euler class. Everything is homotopy invariant. And in particular, if the formal differential, this for formal differential Gödel's algebra, since using the homotopy invariant, you see that the spectral sequence degenerates at the second page. So from D2, D3, the differential, DR is equal, vanish at least area at least 2. This fact, when I see this fact, so again, in application deformation theory, it keep in mind a fact that which was proved by Ruggero Bandiera at the beginning, more than 1 year ago, more or less, so maybe more than one, is that by a different, completely different approach based on derived bracket, he proved that this spectral, if the spectral sequence degenerates at A1, then the differential Gödel's algebra is homotopy abelian. Now after this result, it's natural to ask if all also the converse of this fact, and in fact the answer is yes. And then again, I repeat, with a long list of technical computation involving L infinity algebra and so on, it's possible to prove that for a differential algebra, we have three equivalent conditions. The first is the formality. The second is the degeneration on this page 2 of the Shirley-Hallenberg spectral sequence defined above. And the third condition, which is the more useful for application, is that Euler class, every higher differential annihilates the Euler class. In particular, this go to Euler class go to A infinity part. This is, of course, the implication one imply two and two imply three is trivial. So the only non-trivial fact is prove that three imply one. Okay. Since you have only 5 minutes, let me give very briefly which are the main steps of the proof. The first part is use extend the definition of the spectral sequence, Chevalier-Hallenberg cohomology, to the any L infinity morphism. This is also present in literature. There are some recent papers by Lazarev which study this cohomology for L infinity morphism. It is very standard, not really difficult. The second fact is using the homotopy classification of L infinity algebra and to replace any L infinity algebra to reduce the case when you are work only for to minimal L infinity algebra. It is also possible, but it's a standard fact. Sorry?
You have much more than 5 minutes. We started later, so take your time.
Ah, okay. Oh. I finish in advance. I keep in mind I have more time for questions. It's okay. Thank you. Okay, now this is another inductive step, which is the most technical part. If you consider the Euler class of this, assume that you have a minimal algebra where you have the quadratic part and then also the cubic quartic part equal to zero until the k plus one part, which may be eventually or possibly non-zero. Then, in this case, the Euler class is annihilated by dr for every r strictly less than k, and the k is equal to zero if and only if this algebra is isomorphic to some other. We can push the non-trivial part one step forward. This is just by using some very manual some tricky computation, and finally go to the limit to k is equal to zero just to prove, show that everything can be fair enough. all the isomorphism of step three can be done is in a coherent way, and so on. Actually, it is a result. I studied this part just to my first occasion was to understand an old a paper by Dimitri Kaledin, which is, was essentially which is actually used in the, by for people studying the moduli space of coherent sheaves in some, for instance, K3 surfaces. And just as I arrived to this computation, to this result, as an attempt to understand this paper by Kaledin, which is quite, at the beginning quite hard to read. In fact, Teresa Valeri, if I remember, Lunds proved, rewrite in a more detailed way the same argument. So in some sense, it is some underlying idea are the same of this paper. The most important difference is that they do not consider this Euler class. In fact, it's essentially the basic point, just introduction of this class. Once this, all the proofs are not considered, but they consider another invariant, which is at the beginning, which is quite more complicated to manage, for which also the application are more difficult, which are essentially consider all, instead of consider the spectral sequence, they consider the deformation of the normal cone, and then a global invariant assume that given this part of the triviality of this deformation. Some Kodaira is essentially some base. The main difference is that the introducing the Euler class is important for this. Also, simplify the application, for instance. Also, this result can be applied in the result of formality of families. If you have a family of differential algebra under some assumption, good assumption, if the generic element is formal, also the special element is formal, and so on, but also in this part. Okay, I think I finish in the time which I expected to be true. And, okay, thank you.